go slumming, take me slumming. Let's go slumming on Park Avenue. Let us hide behind a pair of fancy glasses and make faces when a member of the Colossus passes. Let's go smelling where they're dwelling.
Hail and welcome everyone to Celebrating Art, the weekly TV show which spotlights the best of the arts and culture happening in and around the great city of New York. We have a very special episode this week. Actually, it's an episode that I was trying to put off as long as possible. I have to tell you the truth, I really didn't want to do this, but I guess it was crucial that I did it. It took a lot of pulling and twisting to get this guest here, so, just so you know, I want to introduce someone who is a crooner, I know what that is, a model, a film writer, director, producer, and he's a vegan, of all things, and he's an animal rights activist. So what does that mean? We're going to give animals the right to vote? Okay. Please welcome our special guest, Mr. David Giardina. David, nice to have you here.
Thanks, David. Nice to be here.
Let's start right in. You're a vegan. What exactly does that mean? Well, exactly, a vegan means I don't eat anything that comes off of or out of an animal. No animal flesh, eggs, no dairy. Whoa. You're not eating meat. You're not eating dairy. You're not eating eggs. So what's left? Yogurt? No, yogurt is dairy. Dairy comes from animal's milk, like a cow's milk, goat, etc. Wow. Okay. So what about bacon? What? Did you just ask me, what about bacon?
Yeah.
You look kind of wiped out. Not as wiped out as that question. How can you not like bacon? It's very easy not eating the flesh of a tortured, slaughtered pig. How could any human eat that? It's delicious! It's bacon! It's meat candy! No, it's pieces of a dead animal who wanted to live. There are many things that might taste good and even give you a feeling of elation like heroin, but I wouldn't encourage anyone to do it. Especially if it comes from the torture and murder of a living, sentient being. Yes, pigs have feelings and lives, just as you do, just as your dog or your cat. Why would any human being want to be an active part of torture, abuse, and murder? Oh, please. Why do you have to put it that way? That's the way it is.
But we have to eat.
Yes, we do, but we don't have to abuse and murder, do we?
Well,
I don't know about that. Where there's life, there's death. However, we don't have to intentionally cause misery and torture and the destruction of the earth at the same time. Okay, let's back up here. How long have you been on this diet? It's not a diet. I've never been on a diet in my life. Veganism is a lifestyle, not a diet. And I choose this lifestyle because, yes, I want to be healthy. I was always healthy before I was a vegan, but now I feel 100 times better now that I'm not eating flesh, eggs, and dairy. But veganism is really an ethical lifestyle. It does not rely on the active mistreatment, abuse, and killing of sentient beings. For instance, of cows, pigs, chickens, turkeys, fish, lambs. For food, clothing, medicine, cosmetics, entertainment, or really any other reason. And that's what it's about. It's a lifestyle. Well, that sounds pretty extreme. By extreme, what do you mean?
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't mean to sound, offensive.
Oh, it's compulsive. I'm so sorry. Most people like their meat. But it's not their meat. It's the flesh of another animal. Their meat is on their own bodies. Okay. Most people, since the beginning of time, have eaten meat, eggs, and dairy. Well, no. Humans came to this about 6,000 years ago out of a sense of desperation when our natural food sources, in other words, vegetation, were not widely available to us. So we turned to eating animal flesh, eggs, and milk to try to survive. Humans have been on Earth for upwards of, I would say, about 200,000 years. That's relatively recent in our history. We're not really designed to eat meat. Don't you think that if it was really that bad, more people would be saying by now, this is wrong, I shouldn't do it? More and more people are saying, this is wrong, I shouldn't be doing this. And just because the majority of people around the world have been doing something for a long time, does not make it right. We don't have to embrace ignorance simply because it's a long-standing tradition to do so. Most people in the United States, for instance, they thought that it was okay to slaughter millions of Native Americans. Most people thought it was okay to kidnap and enslave black people. Most people thought it was okay for women not to be allowed to vote. Most people thought it was okay to deny same-sex marriage. And those who talked against these institutions were initially shunned and condemned, and worse. Whoa, that's what I mean. You sound very militant. And should I be docile and happy in the face of mass abuse, torture, and murder? But a lot of people are not comfortable with someone always in their face like some kind of Gestapo. That approach will never make people stop eating meat. Well, that says an awful lot about people, doesn't it? So you're saying it makes people uncomfortable to be reminded that eating meat is supporting animal abuse and violence, but they're okay with actually supporting animal abuse and violence? It's offensive to call it animal abuse and violence. People are free to choose, you know, free range or humanely slaughtered. Free range, humanely slaughtered meat. So if I played with your dog and let him run around the backyard and fed him before I slit his throat, that would be humane?
Oh my God.
That would be okay? That's... Dogs aren't even food. They're not on the food chain. They are in other countries. So are cats. But we're not in other countries. That's different. Does it really matter where we are? No sentient being anywhere wants to be abused, enslaved, tortured, or killed.
It tastes good.
According to cannibals, so does human flesh. That tastes good too. Does that justify doing it?
That is really disgusting.
Great point. I think animal rights activists and vegans pushing their views on other people just doesn't work. You're taking the wrong approach if you want to get people to change. I'm sorry. Great. I would love to hear your ideas then. Tell me what to say that will get you to stop supporting animal abuse, and I'll say it.
Yeah. Okay, I get you.
No, I don't think you do. If you did get me, you'd be vegan. Not everyone feels like you do. Everyone has a personal choice.
Personal choice.
So you're saying that someone has the right to choose to physically attack you? Destroy your home? To take your children? No, that's certainly not what I'm saying. No one has the right to do that.
Yet you have the right to do this to others.
That's different!
Really?
How? You can't compare humans to animals.
Sure I can.
All animals have feelings, human or otherwise.
No.
Humans are superior to animals.
Humans are animals.
And no, humans aren't necessarily superior to other species. After all, humans have been on the Earth for the shortest amount of time, yet humans have done the most damage to the planet than any other species.
Wow, you really hate people.
No, on the contrary. I wouldn't be speaking about this if I hated people. I care about all of life. No sentient being wants to be abused. No one deserves to be abused. Humans aren't the only ones entitled to be free, happy, and safe.
Well, what about abortion?
What about it? If you're saying it's wrong to take a vulnerable, completely innocent life, which never harmed anyone, then why do you support the killing of trillions of animals a year?
Wow.
Yeah, I can't wait to hear your answer. Well, it says in the Bible that God put animals on the earth to serve humans.
No, it doesn't.
The Bible says in Genesis that humans were given dominion over all other animals. Dominion means responsibility, not domination. Big difference. And the Bible also says, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. That will be your food.
Well, that's one interpretation.
Oh, I see. So you're eager to find an interpretation of the Bible that supports animal abuse. Anyway, the Bible was written a long time ago.
Then why'd you bring it up?
Oh, I am beside myself.
Mm-hmm.
Why couldn't Monty Taylor interview you?
Well, maybe next time.
You know, I love animals, so I take offense to you saying you love animals, but you eat steak, burgers, chicken, fish, bacon.
Yes?
Then how can you insist you love animals? Those animals aren't pets. That's different. So only animals who are pets have feelings, and the other trillions of animals killed a year don't have feelings? They don't matter? I tell you again, all animals feel the same way. Joy, fear, pain, love. Just like your dog and cat, just like you and me.
Well, your shoes are leather. Isn't that hypocritical?
No, my shoes are not leather. No animals were harmed or killed for my shoes. They're vegan.
Well, what about plants? They have feelings.
Oh, that question is so 20th century. No, plants have no central nervous system. Plants do not have a brain. Plants cannot feel pain. They can't fall in love. They can't have a tantrum. They're responsive for the surroundings as all other organisms are. Yet, that does not mean plants are sentient. There's a very big difference between sentient and living.
Well, the consensus on that has not come out yet.
Oh, yes, it has. There are many reports showing that plants are not sentient. And consider, you cut grass, it grows back. You pick an apple from a tree, it grows other apples. And if you're so concerned about plant abuse, why would you ever support an industry that destroys, pollutes, decimates countless miles of forests and meadows just to raise crops that are used to feed billions of animals that are abused and slaughtered? And how often do you go to plant rights demonstrations?
That is ridiculous.
Exactly. And if a house were burning down, would you run back in and try to save the plants?
Oh, come on.
You wouldn't do this. But I'm sure you might try to go in and save a person or an animal. All right. How do you get your protein? Well, at least it took you a while to ask it. All right. Do you know anyone who's ever died of a protein deficiency?
You need it to survive.
How many people do you know who've died of a protein deficiency?
Well, maybe not personally, but lots of people around the world, like in Africa, die of protein deficiencies.
No, malnutrition, complicated by unsanitary living conditions. It's not due to a lack of protein. Protein itself is not a nutrient. Protein, when eaten, is a stimulant, the same as caffeine or nicotine. You might feel a boost, but it's not energy. The body is literally trying its best to quickly rid itself of something it doesn't want in order to protect you. With protein, it's quite difficult to do this, so the body puts it in layers of fat to keep it away from the vital organs. So, how do we get our protein? By eating amino acids in the form of an enzyme. These are nutrients. The body then takes these nutrients and uses them as the building blocks to protein, meaning our flesh. And the best source of all nutrients, including amino acids, is fresh, unprocessed, raw vegetation. So, we don't have to worry about where do we get our protein. We should be thinking about where are we getting our optimum nutrients. But isn't that limiting? I mean, aren't you bored? Not in the least. I've never experienced more variety than since I've been a vegan. And I've never had such delicious food. What about when you go out to eat? I eat vegan food when I go out to eat. Well, I give you a lot of credit. I have respect what you're doing, but I could never do it. Well, thanks for your respect, but in this case, respect is not a two-way street. What's not to respect about someone who is making a conscious effort not to harm or kill sentient life? And what is there to respect about someone who insists on supporting violence and killing of sentient beings and to the planet which we all share?
So extreme.
You know what's extreme? It's extreme to rely on the suffering and murder of trillions of animals a year for our pleasures, comforts, or profits. You're not going to stop people from eating meat. It's already happening. The world is changing, and it's a good thing. We're in modern times now. Remember, it takes nothing away from you to acknowledge that all sentient beings deserve to live their lives freely, safely, just as you. You're entitled to your choices. Personal choice ends at abuse and violence, don't you think? Here we go. Why do you eat animals? Why do you wear them? Why do you support this?
Because it's tradition. Because I like it.
Because you're addicted. You know it's unspeakably horrifying, yet you do it because you're addicted. The same as someone addicted to heroin or alcohol. So you make illogical excuses to remain addicted.
What?
And I'm reminding you and everyone that we don't need to rely on the abuse and murder of sentient beings for our health, for our comforts, our pleasures, our profits. I'm not here to point a finger and condemn. I'm here to say we all know in our hearts this is true. We can all change this. It's very destructive, and we can change this behavior right this moment.
Okay, what about the Native Americans, the indigenous people? They hunted.
So you're planning to live in a teepee or in an igloo in extreme weather conditions year-round, like traditional Inuits in Canada or Eskimos in the United States?
No, I'm just saying...
Please don't reference indigenous people that way. They are human beings just like everyone else. Don't deify them just to justify your own bad and needless habits.
But bacon, burgers, cheese, fish fries, omelets, delicious.
David, okay, wait a minute. Take a deep breath. Just take a deep breath. Calm down. And we're going to watch this right now. Watch it.
For nearly their entire four-month pregnancies, mother sows are locked in narrow metal stalls barely larger than their own bodies. Many of the animals develop open sores and scratches. Workers often kick, hit, and yell at pigs to move them. Soon after birth, piglets are castrated by workers who cut into their skin and rip out their testicles. Next, the workers chop off their tails. Both of these painful procedures are nearly always done without anesthesia. Many animals die from botched mutilations. Piglets who become sick or injured or who are not growing quickly enough are killed. Common killing methods include throwing animals into bins and painfully gassing them with carbon dioxide. Others are killed by being slammed headfirst into the ground. At a factory farm in Ohio, workers killed injured sows by hanging them on a forklift to be slowly strangled to death, a practice defended by the pork industry. Pigs raised for meat typically live only 5 to 6 months, a mere fraction of their natural lifespan, in overcrowded pens like this. Workers frequently tattoo the animals with ID numbers by hitting them with metal-spiked mallets. Once pigs have reached market weight, they are sent to slaughter. At the slaughterhouse, pigs are knocked in the head with a steel rod, hung upside down, and have their throats slit. Improper stunning condemns many pigs to having their throats slit while they are fully conscious and suffering. Others are even scalded alive in the hair removal tanks. From the moment they hatch, the egg industry subjects chicks to horrors few of us can even imagine. At the hatchery, workers quickly and roughly sort the males from the females. Because male chicks don't lay eggs and do not grow quickly enough to be raised profitably for meat, they are killed within hours after hatching. Male chicks are typically thrown into giant grinding machines while still alive. This practice is deemed standard and acceptable by the egg industry. Another killing method is to drop male chicks into trash bags to be smothered or suffocated. More than 200 million unwanted male chicks are killed on their first day of life each year in the United States. The females have it even worse, destined for a life of prolonged cruelty. To reduce pecking induced by overcrowded living conditions, workers use a hot blade or laser to remove part of the chick's beaks. This mutilation can cause both acute and chronic pain. After debeaking, the birds are moved to cages where they will spend the rest of their lives. Nearly 95% of egg-laying hens spend their lives confined in tiny wire cages like this. Most birds never see sunlight or breathe fresh air. They are packed so tightly they cannot even spread their wings, walk, or turn around without pushing other birds aside. The harsh and unrelenting environment of the cage takes its toll, often leading to severe feather loss, open wounds, and birds trapped in cage wire. For many hens, the stressful confinement is too much, leading to premature death. Undercover investigations at egg farms from coast to coast have revealed a culture of cruelty and neglect, including workers stomping on birds, throwing live hens on dead piles and in trash cans, and painfully mangling bird spines in botched attempts to break their necks. At 1 or 2 years of age, when a hen's egg production begins to decline, she is violently ripped from her cage. Workers often fling the birds into metal carts where they are painfully suffocated with carbon dioxide. Crowded by the thousands into filthy sheds, chickens and turkeys are denied many of their most basic natural behaviors and needs, such as fresh air and exercise. Through genetic selection, chickens and turkeys raised for meat have been bred to grow so large so quickly that many suffer crippling leg disorders, chronic joint pain, and even fatal heart attacks. Sick or injured birds often have their necks broken. Others are clubbed to death. Those who live to reach market weight are thrown into transport crates and loaded onto trucks bound for slaughter plants. Handling is often violent and frequently causes bruises, broken bones, and other injuries. At the slaughter plant, the birds are dumped from their crates, then roughly snapped upside down into moving shackles by their fragile legs. From there, the birds are dragged through an electrified vat of water, which renders them paralyzed, but not necessarily unconscious. They are then pulled across a blade which slices their throats, causing blood to pour from their necks. Some of the birds who miss the blade have their throats slit or their heads ripped off by a backup killer. Other birds are drowned and scalded in the tanks of hot water designed to loosen the bird's feathers. Cows produce milk for the same reasons that humans do, to nourish their young. But calves on dairy farms are dragged away from their mothers and violently killed, all so that humans can have the milk instead. The majority of today's dairy cows are confined on factory farms. Some spend almost their entire lives standing on concrete floors. Others are crammed into massive mud lots. Workers subject young cows to painful mutilations and amputations. Here, a worker cuts off a cow's tail, slicing through her sensitive skin, nerves, and bone without any painkillers. Another routine practice is dehorning, burning into the calves' skulls to remove their budding horns. Painkillers are rarely used. A 2010 undercover investigation at a dairy farm in Ohio revealed a farm worker stabbing cows with pitchforks, beating them in the head with crowbars, and punching baby calves. Injuries and illness often run rampant in filthy, disease-ridden factory farm environments. Cows too sick or injured to stand are called downers and are often left to slowly suffer and die from their injuries. At a fraction of their natural lifespan, the so-called spent dairy cows are prodded onto transport trucks and shipped to slaughterhouses. An undercover investigation at a slaughterhouse in California revealed downed dairy cows being kicked, shocked, pushed with forklifts, and water hosed in the mouth and nostrils in an effort to get them to the kill floor. Most cattle raised for beef endure several mutilations without painkillers, including castration and hot iron branding. Most spend the last few months of their lives in overcrowded feedlots, standing in their own waste. Unreliable stunning practices at the slaughterhouse condemn many cattle to having their throats cut and their limbs hacked off while still alive and conscious. Undercover investigations at kosher slaughterhouses in the United States have documented the routine practice of cutting open the throats of fully aware and alert cattle. Fish and other sea animals are sensitive, intelligent creatures who have a demonstrated capacity to suffer pain. Massive trawling nets indiscriminately drag hundreds of tons of fish and other animals along the ocean floor. As they are dragged up from the ocean depths, the fish undergo excruciatingly painful decompression. The extreme changes in pressure can rupture their swim bladders and pop out their eyes. They are then tossed on board where the surviving fish either suffocate or are crushed to death. Others are still alive when they are hacked apart on these floating slaughterhouses. Untold millions of dolphins, turtles, and other non-target aquatic animals are also killed by ocean trawler nets each year. Today, approximately 1 in 5 fish consumed worldwide is raised in captivity. Like factory-farmed animals on land, farm-raised fish are crowded by the tens of thousands in small, disease- and excrement-ridden areas for their entire lives. When fish reach market weight, they are loaded onto tanker trucks and shipped to slaughter, where common killing methods include slow suffocation. Farmed animals are every bit as intelligent, curious, and capable of feeling pain and suffering as the dogs and cats so many of us know and love. If you are at all moved by this film, please do your part. Make a commitment today to explore a vegan diet. It could be one of the best decisions of your life. By withdrawing our support of this cruel and violent system, we can put our ethics on the table and make a statement for a kinder and more compassionate society for all animals.
Wow. I don't know what to say. Well, all I have to say is, go vegan. Nothing is stopping you. You don't need to be angry. You don't need to be resentful or respiteful that I'm saying this. And I'm saying the same exact thing to all of you watching. I'm inviting you to go vegan. We're all creatures of habit. But going vegan is one of the best and easiest habits you could ever form. Truly. You won't be missing anything except the cruelty and the health problems and the pollution. Okay, Dave. I do get it. Thank you. It's good for us to sit down and have these talks with ourselves, isn't it? I think so, too. Hug? Maybe under the circumstances, no. Air kiss. I'm going to go vegan right now, and I hope you do, too. Join us next time on Celebrating Art, and I'll see you then.
Let's go slumming. Take me slumming. Let's go slumming on Park Avenue. Let us hide behind a pair of fancy glasses and make faces when a member of the classes passes. Let's go smelling where they're dwelling, sniffing everything the way they do. Let us go. Go slumming, no slumming on Park Avenue. Let's go smelling where they're dwelling, sniffing everything the way they